Chad Lamont Butler, aka Pimp C, was born on December 29, 1973, to his mother, Weslyn Butler, and his father, Charleston Butler. As a small kid, he lived in Crawley, Louisiana, but his family later moved to Port Arthur, Texas. He also had a very rough childhood due to the numerous birth defects that he had. He was born premature. He had an issue with his legs that made him point inward, so he had to wear braces. He also had to be propped up when he was a baby as he slept because he had digestive issues. He also almost went blind due to a bad case of pink eye, and he had pneumonia like 9 times. So man, he went through a lot, you know, and maybe being in the church helped him out, you know, because as a young kid, that's what he did. He was a part of the choir, learned how to play different instruments and things like that. He was always surrounded by music. His dad was actually a musician. And even once his mom and dad split up, her new husband, Bill Monroe, he was a musician also. You know, and he would encourage a young Pimp C to do music, write his own music, things like that. And that's when he started teaching himself how to learn how to play things by ear. That's how he learned how to play the piano and the drums, along with listening to different types of music. Like Pimp C said, he was influenced by like Italian sonnets, Negro spirituals, African music. I mean, music was all around him. And eventually this love for music led him to get together with his good friend, Bernard Freeman, AKA Bun B. And in 1987, they formed the group UGK, AKA Underground Kings. And the reason that they said they named the group the Underground Kings is because the type of music they was gonna make was gonna be so funk based, so blues based, and so country that it would never go mainstream. Because this was a time when New York was very dominant, you know, and the South just didn't get a lot of respect. They was pretty much known for like, you know, booty music basically. But UGK was coming with something else, and they was demanding respect for the South. And throughout their high school years, the duo would continue to work on their musical craft, you know, but they didn't really make a lot of leeway in the music game for a while. And when they graduated in May of 1991, Bun B went to Pimp C and told him like, hey man, if this music thing don't work out in the next year, just gonna go on and, you know, live a regular life basically. And that was in May of 1991. And wouldn't you know that a year later, literally May of 1992, they ended up getting signed to Jive Records. And that's when they dropped their debut album, Too Hard to Swallow. Now, this album didn't get a lot of mainstream success. It didn't even break the Billboard Top 200. But what it did do is it gave UGK the respect that they was seeking. It had classics on there like Use Me Up, Something Good, and Pocket Full of Stones. And that song was actually featured on the Menace to Society soundtrack as well. But their next album, Super Tight, which dropped in 1994, that would be the album that kind of propelled them into the mainstream, because not only did it break the Billboard Top 200, it peaked at number 95. And it had like classic songs like Front Back Side to Side. You know, that hadn't been sampled so much. And in 1996, they released their critically acclaimed album, Riding Dirty. And this had classics on it like Diamonds and Wood, Pinky Ring. And this is when the hip hop world really started taking notice of UGK, like the entire hip hop world. And it's funny because Pimp C's friend named Mike Mo, he said Pimp C would tell him like he didn't think he was that good of a rapper like himself. He just felt like people liked the way that he sound. But yeah, I disagree with Pimp on that one. Pimp C could definitely rap. But for some reason, after dropping this classic album, UGK, they wouldn't come out with another album for another 5 years. I mean, in between this time, they did work with other artists and do features, but no UGK albums. But in the year 2000, they would bust back on the scene when they linked up with 3-6 Mafia and recorded the classic song, Sippin' on Some Scissor. And then they would follow that up by getting with Jay-Z and recording the hit song, Big Pimpin'. Now the funny story behind the Big Pimpin' song is that Pimp C, he hated that beat. Like when they sent it over to him, he was like mad. You know, that's why his verse was only 8 bars instead of 16. Cause when he got the beat, he was like, man, they trying to play me. Like I'm about to rap the most countryest stuff I can think of on here. People ain't even gonna be able to understand me. So he was really on there clowning for real, but it still came out hot anyways. Unfortunately, Jive Records failed to capitalize on the momentum that UGK had built up that year by being featured on such big songs, because for whatever reason, they didn't support UGK's next album. They didn't start pushing it, even though the fans was waiting on it and it had been 5 years. So the hot streak that they were on in 2000 kind of went to waste. And the year would end on an even worse note, because on December 16, 2000, Pimp C was arrested at the Sharpstown Mall in Houston. Now, the story goes, he got into some type of altercation with a woman. And according to the woman, Pimp C pulled a gun out and stuck it to her side and said, "Bitch, I'll shoot you." Now, Pimp C's side of the story is he just showed her the gun to scare her or whatever. But either way, once he was leaving the mall, he ended up being surrounded by police. And allegedly, they like slammed him on the ground and kind of roughed him up real bad. He posted bond the next day for $10,000. And eventually, you know, he went to court and they just put him on probation. But Pimp C, you know, he was his own man and he was going to do what he was going to do. So he didn't pay none of the court fees. He wasn't showing up to meetings. He was dropping dirty. I mean, like everything that you're not supposed to do while you on papers, that's what Pimp C was doing. And eventually the judge, he gave it to him on August 5th, 2002. They sentenced Pimp C to 8 years in prison.
I allowed for the situation to happen where these people could keep me caught up in this system.
But out of the system, Pimp C is far from irrelevant. He says he still gets fan mail, radio airplay, and what he calls love from the industry.
Pimp C would make the most out of his time in prison, and he would always receive love. He said that he would get thousands of fan mail letters. And he also went on to marry his childhood sweetheart, Chanara Butler. And he taught himself how to use the newest drum machine as well, thanks to the help of his new friend, David Banner, because David Banner was a huge fan. So he said he wrote Pimp while he was in prison and they just formed a bond. And eventually, you know, through pictures, he taught him how to use the newest drum machine, because y'all know Pimp, he was about his music. And he also obtained his GED while he was locked up too. So he definitely made the most out of his time in there. And he had an opportunity to reflect on his life. And on December 30th, 2005, when he was released from the Terrell Unit Prison in Texas, he was greeted by family, friends. It was nothing but love. And Pimp C was ready to take the rap game over again and help the South get to the top. One of the first things that Pimp C did when he touched down was make sure that he got all of the big Houston artists together so they can squash whatever petty beefs that they had, because it was like a civil war going on in the city of Houston during this time. And that disappointed Pimp C, because he knew that the city was stronger together than they were apart. And after that, he ended up starting UGK Records, and he already was affiliated with Trill Entertainment, who had artists like Boosie and Webby, you know, when they was real hot during that time. And even though Pimp C's debut album, Sweet James Jones Stories, came out in 2005, it kind of wasn't an official album because he wasn't out to promote it. It wasn't music videos, so it really wasn't the same. But in 2006, when he released his official debut album, Pimpalation, that one debuted at number 3 on the charts, and it actually ended up going gold. So now Pimp C had his solo success. Bun B was doing his thing with the Trill album, making hits. They came together for the hit single, Get Throwed. They was doing their thing. And it was really only one thing for UGK to do now, and that was get back together and make another classic album. 2007 would be the year that UGK let the world know that they were back. They dropped the album, Underground Kings, and it had songs like Game Belongs to Me, Two Types, and it also had the smash hit international players anthem, I Choose You, featuring Outkast, another legendary hip-hop group. Now, it's a funny story behind this song because Project Pat, he actually used that beat in 2002 on his album, Laying the Smackdown. He had a song called Choose You, and Pimp C loved the beat. And he hit up DJ Paul from 3-6 Mafia and told him, like, hey, man, when I get out, I'm going to use that beat. And people in his camp tried to tell Pimp C, like, nah, man, don't use it. People already heard it. And they said Pimp C was just like, so what, man? They're going to hear it again. Pimp C was a fool, man. And actually, Bun B said shooting this video was the most fun he ever had making a music video because of all the love that they was getting. They shot the video during BET Award weekend, so a lot of the cameos you see was just random people popping up, showing, you know, UGK their respect. So UGK, they was back on top, where they belong. This would also be the same time that Pimp C would begin to speak his mind on how he viewed the music industry and how evil that he felt it was. And he also started to speak on the people in the music industry and some of their preferences.
And you rap, and you staying in the closet, then you need to come on out of the closet and let us know who you is. Because if you ain't proud of what you do, then don't do it. And if anything you're ashamed of, you shouldn't be doing it. You know who's getting caught in the Range Rover with the bar. You know what's going on in that lounge, just like I know. You know who got caught in the Range Rover with the bar. Yeah. UGK was started out talking about drugs and things. But now we on the records talking about the other side of the drugs and what happens when you get off into negative things. We need to stop promoting the wrong thing.
Making comments like that could definitely cause you some problems in the music industry. But Pimp C was the type of guy, he was going to speak his mind. And if he felt the way, he was definitely gonna let you know about it. In December of 2007, he was staying at the Mondrian Hotel in West Hollywood because him and Too Short was working on an album together. But on December 4th, he was scheduled to fly back to Texas because he had a probation meeting, and he never missed those because he was not trying to get locked up again. But while his wife was at the airport waiting for him, she couldn't get in contact with him. She had his cousin call him as well. Could nobody talk to Pimp C? Eventually, she called the hotel and had them do a welfare check. And when they did, the next thing that happened was they contacted his manager, Rick Martin, who was also the manager at that time of DJ Paul from 3-6 Mafia as well. And he called DJ Paul and he was speeding down to the hotel. Like, you know, they wouldn't tell him what happened. They just told him he needed to get down there. DJ Paul went too. And once they entered the room, according to DJ Paul, it was blood all over the room. It was like blood on the ceiling, blood all over the floor, all over the walls. And Pimp C was like knelt down in a praying position in front of two big candles where they used to be big candles, but they had burnt all the way down. So that's kind of how they know he'd been there for a minute. So that's how they found him, bent down in a praying position, with blood all over the room in front of these two big candles. It's crazy. The death of Pimp C left the hip hop world in shock and brought tears to the cities of Port Arthur and Houston because he was the heart and soul of those places. The official cause of death was overdose due to a combination of promethazine and codeine and a pre-existing condition of sleep apnea. But not everybody was buying an overdose as the reason of Pimp C's death due to the manner in which he was found in, especially legendary Houston producer Michael Watts.
I'm pretty sure at some point everybody had a question in their mind about him passing. You know, sometimes people say that he had a drug overdose and then somebody said there was blood all over the room. I mean, shit, man, you know. If somebody have a drug overdose, there's not blood all over the room.
Now, allegedly, when Pimp C checked into his room, he was accompanied by a woman. But when he was found, he was by himself, and the woman was never seen. So who really knows what happened? What is known is that Pimp C is no longer with us, but his legacy and the music that he left behind will always live on. I really wanted to make this video because Pimp C is one of my favorite rappers and I love UGK, and I just wanted to pay him his respect. And even though he's not here anymore, he'll never be forgotten. Long live Pimp C. And he was only 33 years old when he died, man. Rest in peace.